had a lot of emails from people asking how to sharpen my spoon blades. I think it's time to make a video on it. I've actually had four goes doing this, and they haven't gone well. But Alex is along. He's doing a cooks and gardening workshop over here this weekend, so we're going to have another go at filming it. So although this video is going to be on sharpening spoon blades, or my spoon blades, I will talk a little bit about edge geometry, and which explains why my blades are as they are. So the standard Scandi grinds, 25 degrees, 20, 25 degrees, straight bevels. So they're absolutely brilliant for doing a planing cut where the bevel engages and guides the cut. So you get a nice, smooth, easy cut. What they're not so good for is if you want to cut around inside a curve. So they will you can do it, but they will tend at a certain point to chat, you can hear it. Because a straight bevel is not going to want to go around a curve. And the steeper you go, the more difficult it gets until you get this pronounced chatter. Mm-hmm. And there's ways to get around it by using the tip of the blade, which gives you a shorter bevel, which is more likely to go round. So I can go around with the tip and take a smooth cut, or you can, even if you're using the longer bevel, you can take a shorter, less of a cut, and then you can go round. And I think the reason for that is because the wood is pretty soft, really. My background is in metalwork, and if you tried to do this cut in metal, there's no way that you could, with a flat bevel tool, cut rounds inside the curve. You just can't do it. But because the wood's soft, it will compress. But all the time, the wood is fighting the back of the bevel, which is what makes it difficult. And so I'm sure people have come up against this in spoon carving. You must see it on the inside of the boulder.
Right. So what we're talking about is this inside curve here, where the stem meets the bowl. You know, a lot of beginners have problems trying to get a nice, clean, continuous cut because you get chatter where those two points meet. So you can get away with it a little bit on the tip, like he was saying, with a less aggressive of a cut, and by compressing those fibers down.
Yes. So that's the carving which I most often do, is carving an axe handle, but not with a head on. But cutting around here, I'll get this chatter quite often, so I will actually use a spoon knife. I'll use the straightest part of a spoon knife and come round, and I can get a nice smooth cut because it's got a curved bevel which matches the curve that I'm taking.
Right.
I think that's the point I'm trying to make, is that you want to match the bevel of the blade to the cut you're trying to make. So Scandi grind is great for flat plane cutting. It will also cut, say, around the top of the spoon bowl. But if you want to cut on the inside into the neck, as you know, it's more difficult. If you want to try and take out the spoon bowl, you really won't do it. Even if you curve the blade, if you've got a flat bevel, you'll still get this chatter. However, if you've got a curved bevel, it will cut inside a curve much easier. So this blade has got a curve on it. So obviously it's got a curve going this way, but the bevel is also curved in this plane, which throws up the first difficulty of sharpening it. It's very difficult to sharpen a blade which is curving like that. If you try to hit it with a water stone or a diamond stone, anything hard, it's very difficult to find where the edge is at any one point because it's curved. And also, it's not just you've got to find this and then work, you've got to work round in the other plane. So trying to hit the edge perfectly around here is very difficult. So my solution to that is not to do it. It's to stay away from the outside as much as possible. I've put a lot of effort in getting this profile right, and to a large extent you can just leave that alone. However, what I have done is I've put a lot of effort into hollowing the inside, so we've got these two characteristic tram lines which make it very easy to sharpen, because if you put a dowel across it, it will automatically sit across this and the tool will follow the dowel. So if I put the tool down, put the dowel on a press, it would just hold it. If I move the dowel, the tool will follow it. So if you're working across these two tram lines, you'll hit the edge every time. So it just makes it so much easier to sharpen. So the sharpening is basically done from the inside, the outside, large, as much as possible, leave alone, because it's much more difficult to do.
So that's quite different than most of the opinions I've heard from other tool makers and other videos I've seen online, that they always tell you to leave the inside bevel alone and only sharpen the outside, but you're telling us to do the opposite.
Yes, Yes. Yes, no, that's true. But then my edge geometry is different to other blades. We've got this convex bevel on the outside, which is very difficult to hit, and the inside is easy to hit, so you're just doing the easiest thing. If you look at a Mora knife, Mora spoon knife, it's curved on the inside, so I can actually, if I put a dowel on and rock it, there's a lot of places it sits and feels like I'm on the edge, so I could be rubbing away on the inside and not actually hitting the edge.
Right.
So it's more difficult to know the hitting the edge. I can rock it up until I hit the edge, but I might then be rounding it. On the other hand, the bevel on this is relatively flat, so it is fairly easy to locate and hit an edge, or just hit the edge and not round it, so you can sort of feel that and run around. And yeah, and that will work. But you do have the issue of the flat bevel when you carve. It's not going to carve as easily as a curved bevel. But so my blade's different, so they have a different sharpening.
So I do a lot of sharpening since I'm carving pretty much daily, and I can imagine for a beginner it's very frustrating trying to just maintain a consistent bevel. Cause, I mean, it's very important. You don't want to change too much geometry on either the inside or outside, because then you have a lot of cleanup work to do. So being able to only sharpen the inside and have this built-in guide in a way, I think that would solve a lot of frustration, build a lot more confidence with your skills in sharpening.
Yes. Yeah. Now, when I started off making spoon blades, I did follow the standard sort of geometry, which most blades follow this. And you can get a blade very sharp. And I'd send blades out to people, or at a show, I'd sell a blade, and it cut very well. But they'd come back a year later, and quite often they'd absolutely destroyed the geometry because they'd rounded this inside, and they'd round the inside. You'd end up with an edge which was like this. Mm. And it's very difficult to recover from that. So that's one of the reasons I came up with this geometry, is because people were having difficulty sharpening. And now people buy blades from me, and I'll see them a year later, and they'll be just as sharp as when they got them, which is great, because it's, say, sharpening. It's all very well sending someone out a sharp blade, but if they can't maintain it, it's just going to go downhill. So it's,
right, and I think that's one of the big frustrations in builds a lot of anxiety is being afraid to sharpen your own tools. I mean, it took me like a year before I really wanted to take it on as a beginner, because I was afraid I'd mess everything up. So being able to just know that you can just lay something flat and it has its own built-in guide, I think would be a big game changer for a lot of people. Yes. There's nothing more frustrating than trying to make your nice clean cuts and your projects just withering away. And also, the more sharpening you do, you're removing a lot of precious metal that you want. So it's nice to be able to only remove what you need to.
Yes, and if you take a little bit away in the wrong place, you've got a huge amount of metal to take away to
right.
recover it. Whereas if you follow this method, you only take away tiny amounts, and it will last longer as well. And it's quick, which is the main thing, because no one really enjoys sharpening, I don't think. so if you can, the quicker you can get back to carving, the better.
Yeah.
So that's the idea. Yeah. So coming to actually sharpen the blade, I think the first thing is to see how blunt it is, to give you an idea of the degree of sharpening you want to do. So I go to cut with this one here, and just see what sort of cut it will do. And you can see, I mean, that's obviously cutting very well. If it was cutting this well, all I would probably do is strop, because I can see that there's no track lines on it. It's not chattering, there's not really much that needs to be done. So that in that case, it will just need stropping. But assuming that I damaged it, and I hate to do this, but it doesn't take a lot to don't really like doing that, but otherwise, well, how do you blunt and blade it? At this point, when I cut, I've got one. If you're lucky, you can see where it is, but the wood is actually more sensitive, and you can see track lines. See scratch lines running along here, and what I find really useful is to make a cut, line it up with track lines, and then just mark the inside of the blade with a sharpie or whatever where it needs doing, because it's easy to forget, particularly on a blade which goes round much further, which bit needs doing. There's no point spending ages on a bit
right.
which you don't need to hit. So you could argue that, yeah, you're going to get a slight dip in that area, but realistically, it's only tiny amounts.
Right, microscopic.
and you really just want to get back to carving rather than take loads off the whole plate. So I know that I need to do work on this area, so that's something I'll concentrate on. So when you've got a ding like that, which isn't major, but there is a ding, we need to remove a certain decent amount of steel, but not a huge amount. I do these in 20s normally, so I have these pre-cut, but this is just a sheet of paper which has been cut in half and then cut into strips, so I'll get maybe 20 strips out of a sheet, so it's a cheap way to do it.
Yes. No, so where can we find abrasive paper like this?
It's wet or dry paper. It's sold fairly widely. It's used in the auto industry for rubbing down paint with vinaigrettes. I do sell it on my website, but you can find it a lot of places. Halfords in the UK sell it. They're quite easy to come by, buy it online. But yes, but it's worth getting good quality paper. The cheap stuff doesn't last as long. But having said that, I cut it up and I don't actually use it for very long. If I do a strip like this, I'll get between two or three blades out of it and then I'll throw it away because it's just not worth. It degrades very quickly. But poor quality paper will degrade so quickly and then it will start breaking up and that will scratch it and that makes it worse. So it's not worth scrimping on abrasives. But yes, strip like this, wrap it round dowel. And all I do is I wrap it round because, as I say, I will be doing maybe 20 blades at a time and I'll get three out of this. So I'll be changing it seven times or so if I was going to. If I glued it on, I'd spend more time gluing and peeling it off. The other option is, of course, to wrap it round, which I've seen people do, which will work. But the issue with that is that because you've got lots of layers of paper, there's a bit more give in it.
Right, compresses down.
And the whole idea is that I want this to be really flat, so I want it as thin and as hard as possible. I mean, you could use steel, which would be even harder, but the chances of digging, I mean, occasionally I cut on the wood and that's all right, so, but if you wanted the best finish, yes, you could use a steel bar, but I think maybe that's taken that a bit far. It will last longer, wet or dry paper lasts longer if you wet it, so what I tend to do is just dip it into the water, but I say it doesn't last very long anyway. So what I'll do is I wrap it round, I'll wet it, and I will run away from the edge, a bit of rotation is nice, and just work on the area. I can see the Sharpie mark where I marked it, so I know which bit to work on. And it won't take very long because the effective bevels you're working on are only a couple of millimetres wide, so it's not a lot of steel we're trying to remove. What I'll do next is 1200 grit is relatively coarse, and I can just about feel when a burr's appeared, and that means I've definitely hit the edge. Which isn't quite yet, so I'll do a little bit more.
Something I've noticed is you're holding the knife different than I would. I'm right-handed.
Oh, right, yes, that's true, yes. Yeah, because I do this professionally, most of my time is spent doing right-handed blades. So as a left-hander, you're seeing a left-hander sharpening a right-handed blade, which is perhaps a bit easier because I'm pulling away. If I'm doing a left-handed blade, which I'll show you, different one, but it's the same idea, left-handed blade like this. What you can't do is push. I still want to work away to the edges this side. So if I push away from the edge, that won't work as well because you can get the paper wrinkling up because you're pushing. You need to hold the paper in tension. So you need to be pulling away from, you need to be working. You still got to work away from the edge, but you want the paper in tension. So if you have a way around that, it's not quite as easy. But if you hold it this way, then you can work away from the edge and hold the paper in tension.
I've never thought to flip the tool around
facing into me. That's easier because then you're still working away and keep the paper in tension so it doesn't ruck up. This chair's great for that. It really does make it easier. This chair's had a lot of use, but there are other ways to do it. I wouldn't rest it on your knee because it's not hard enough, but if you've got a table, you can do that, although it's not so easy to put that in
front of you,
to be fair. But so could you work on the edge of a table? You could work on the corner of a table.
Or could you work off the edge of a spoon carving stump, carving
block?
Yes, if you're
over it. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
But it's easier sitting down where you're comfortable.
Yes. Well, the other way to do it is just to learn to do it if you're a right-hander. It's because you haven't done it before, it won't necessarily feel too odd for you to do it as a left-hander.
Okay.
So just do it with your right-handed. Just do this with your... just do this with your left hand. So, yeah, as a left-hander, if I were saying, it's probably confused everybody, but, you know, welcome to my world, yes. If you, yeah. This is what it's like for me all the time, trying to work out what's right and what's left. The other way for me to sharpen a left-handed blade, which is a bit difficult, is not to use my left hand to do sharpening. Is to do it this way, so I can on this side. Okay. So that's what you do. Yes, and now same thing. It locates on here, and I run away from the edge so the paper's in tension. So that's the other thing. So I'd just be using my effectively wrong hand.
So the rule of thumb with sandpaper especially is pulling.
Yes, because if you push, it will wrinkle up, right. And you'll get these folds, and that will put a scratch in it. So you've right. got to be in tension with that. If you glue it down, you get around sure. that, but then you'll spend more time
right.
taking it off and putting it on again. So I think that's the best way. So at this stage, I have now sharpened this enough, I can feel a slight burr on the area, which I'm trying to get rid of the nick in it. Which should mean that it will cut smoothly, because if I've hit good metal, I should have got through. It's a really deep dent, obviously, just because you feel burnt right. doesn't mean you got rid of it, but that should cut all right.
That's something interesting to bring up. It took me the longest time to even know what a burr was. I've seen pictures of little flimsy piece of metal, and I still, for the longest time, didn't know what it was, and I think my problem was is I wasn't sharpening from an aggressive enough abrasive, so yes. I wasn't actually ever making a burr. I was polishing the yes. mistakes.
Yeah. It's still there, but you can't feel it. I think that's part right. of it. Is that on 3000 grit, which we'll use next, I can't feel a burr. There is a tiny burr, but it's my fingers aren't sensitive enough.
So it's because I noticed a lot of times you can't even see it. So you have to develop, learn how to use touch to find it.
Yes, but so I'm running my fingers away from the edge. And I can feel a little point where it's dragging where I've got burr. So what I want to do now is wipe that burr off because it's not going to cut very well. At this stage, rather than trying to keep it dead flat, I'm going to be stropping. And there's a little bit of give in this is just some suede glued to MDF. And that's got a little bit of give, which makes it much easier to find the edge because it will wrap round and follow the edge, so it's not all or nothing whether you've hit or not. I'm going to cheat now. It's much better to have two strops. If you're doing grey and white, which are the two compounds, it's much better to have two separate strops, but I haven't. And rather than cut this in half, I've labelled it G and W, and hopefully I won't mess up. So grey compound is the coarser one, and I'll just rub this on. Don't want to put too much on. Rub it on like a crayon, and then I run away from the edge, and you can see black line appearing, which is steel, which has been cut. So run away from the edge. Quite a lot of down pressure, and with practice, you'll feel a point where you're hitting the edge. But you don't want to roll around the edge. You're just aiming to just, and all you're trying to do is remove the burr. You're not doing anything more than that. So that's now. And this isn't a brilliant edge, but it's good enough that if you try it, if I cut now, I should see that I'm not getting any tram lines. So if you're happy with that, go on to the next stage. There's no point going on to the final stage, getting the perfect edge, try it, then find you've got to go back through the grit. So try it at this stage. If you've removed, if you've got rid of any edge damage, then you're ready to move on to the next grade.
Something I wanted to bring up actually is something that you taught me that I thought was a very valuable lesson is to always look at the wood chips you're picking up, because with a dull tool, it's very hard to see probably from there, but you'll get these very toothy cuts, and the chip that he just made after he removed the burr, you can see it's very smooth, very clean chip.
Yes.
So I thought that was a great tip. I've never heard anybody recommend
it'll
that.
It'll get better at a higher edge. But yeah, I think I've been thinking a lot about that, is that if you're getting a, there's one here, I don't even really be able to see it. Even this, where the edge is running away, it's not particularly toothy. But if it is toothy, part of the reason is that I think that means that the last cut you did, or the cut before the last one you did, left a fairly, I'll see if I can make it chatter. If you leave a chattery finish, so you haven't got a smooth finish, when you do the next cut, even if it's smooth, the chatter lines are going to effectively leave a tooth edge. So I think that's part of the reason you can get this bad finish. Because I was thinking about that, is because one of the quirks of the shows is that I've basically had to demonstrate right-handed blades, because unfortunately most people are right-handed. So what I've learned to do is I can carve left-handed or right-handed blade relatively well. I can carve right-handed with a right-handed blade, not brilliantly, but enough to show people. I always get told off about this because it's awful. Chris Allen told me off terribly for bad technique.
Carving into your thumb.
Yeah, yeah. Anyway, but I can carve reasonably with a right-handed blade. But probably what I'm worst at is carving left-handed with a left-handed blade. But that's just a quirk of it. But what happens is I don't carve as well right-handed with a right-handed blade. And if you look at the cuts I'm taking now, if you look at a shaving, we've got this jagged edge.
Mm-hmm.
And it isn't because the blade's blunt, it's poor technique.
Right. Okay.
So it's not an absolute. But if you're carving and you suddenly find you're getting these bad edges to your scalloped edges like this, it probably means the blade's blunt, that's most likely. But I say it isn't absolute, because you can with a sharp blade with poor technique, which I just demonstrated.
Right. And another, I guess another tip other than visually looking at the chip is the sound of the chip has changed before you sharpened. You could hear, it was more of a rough scraping sound. Mm. So you're actually scraping wood and probably pulling fiber versus cutting across fibers, and then you get this nice smooth. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely. Yes. It will not. Yes. Yeah. We'll try and.
So it's good to develop. Good to develop a sense of hearing, and you know, so it's touch, sight, and hearing, sharpening and carving.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, when I'm at a show and I'll show somebody how to carve, I quite often leave them to it, because once they get carving, and I can just listen to what's going on. Mm-hmm. I can tell from the sound of the cut if they're carving well, and if I'm hearing a lot of clicking and.
Exactly.
Crispy noise, that's not good. But if you're hearing a smooth, clean cut, which we'll try and get, I think, that tells you a lot. So you can hear how sharp the blade is. So the next stage of sharpening is going to be to take the scratch marks out. So we've got 1200, we're going to take that up to 3000. It does sound like a big jump. However, because the bevels are so thin, the actual amount of metal we've got to remove is small, and you can take these huge jumps. Some people will go 1200, 1500, 2000, 2500, all the way through, but I've found I can make this jump to 3000, which is great, because, as I say, the less time you spend sharpening, the better, really. So, piece of 3000 grit paper. And again, I'll wet this just to make it cut a little bit easier. Wet the blade, and I will take out the 1200 grit scratches, which really shouldn't take very long. I try and slow down. Normally I have a stack of 20 of these, so I try and get through it quicker. So one of the troubles of the past videos I made is I've done everything at full speed, and it's just a blur, really.
Right.
So I'll try and slow down. But also I want to show that it can be done quickly, so it's a balance, I suppose. But so I'm working. Again, keep the paper in tension, away from the edge, and a bit of rotation so you're not using the same bit of sandpaper all the time. And that'll do it. That's all it needs. So I tend to wash off the worst of the grit. I mean, that would probably do another two blades, but no more. Wipe off any abrasive, that's always useful, rather than leave that. So now we've got to a stage where we've got 3,000 grit scratches, but we've got the grey scratches on the outside blade, well, the scratches from the grey compound. So I will put some white compound on the other side.
Do you have any tips for when you're applying compound? I know some people will say to oil their leather, or sometimes some people will heat it up. It's pretty cold in here for winter, so.
Yeah, I've never found it an issue. I think quite a lot of downwards pressure, not light, but I've not really found it. I think maybe different compounds apply differently, but this is what I use all the time, and it works.
Right. Yeah, because it looks like it's going on nice.
Yes, it goes on easily. I think where people have difficulty is that when it goes shiny like this, is they try and apply some more, and it won't really stick on shiny compounds. So what is important bit like all Japanese water stones is you don't let them get in a bad state, you clean them all the time. So this is just a bit of steel which has got a burr on it. You scrape this off. Get rid of all that. It doesn't need a lot.
So you could do this with a chore knife, something that's not your precious carving knife.
Yes, because it will destroy the edge, to be fair. But yeah, scrape it off with something which say you don't care about, and apply a little bit fresh. Don't, if you build up a layer, it cuts best if the compound is in the suede rather than built up in a big waxy layer.
Right, little globules on top.
Yes, so a thin layer like this, and then I'll work through this. So push it down, locate to the edge, and then this isn't too easy to do, I have to say, but you can do it. Sometimes when I started off, I'd do the sort of the flatter section like this, and then I'd do the curved section. So I'd do it in two stages. So
that's okay to do?
Yes, yeah.
So I've seen a lot of videos where they have all these jiu-jitsu moves to try to get it in one go, and I think it's, for most people, it's impossible.
Yeah, well, I mean, I do it in one go because it is quicker, but, I mean, the cut on this is so minor that it's not like you're going to leave a step where you've done this and then you've joined it up there.
Okay.
Plus, also, this is soft, so it will tend to blend
right.
in. It's
so
not going to leave
two.
A step. So it's absolutely fine to do flat bit, curved bit. So that's what, that's polished the outside. So the outside is finished, as far as I'm concerned. The inside is still left at 3000 grit, which is good, but we can do better than that. This is the dowel which I've been using, and this end is wet because I've been dipping it, so I tend to use the dry end. This has been used for stropping quite a bit. I mean, yeah, really, I probably shouldn't use the same dowel which has had 3000 grit paper on, but I think you can take sharpening too far. I don't think
right.
I want to obsess about it too much. I
like the idea of stress-free sharpening, because
it
brings
a lot
of anxiety.
But I mean, I wouldn't use the wet bit again because the compound won't stick to it. So hold the wet bit.
So it's probably wax-based.
Yes, this is the wax-based compound, which is great because one of the things I always do when I finish carving is give everything a polish. Partly so it's sharp when it comes out, which is nice, but also you leave a little layer of wax on, which will stop it rusting, so you're just protecting the tools at the same time. So, yeah, that's great. So, what I'll do is rather than try and make compound stick to old compound, is I'll use the same bit of steel and just scrape off the... you don't have to get it all off, as I say, there's no point, but as long as most of it's off, so doing this doesn't take any time. And a thin layer. If you put too much on, even if it's onto clean wood, it's still going to be, you're just going to be sharpening on a big lump of wax rather than abrasive wood. So all I do now is exactly the same thing, is run away from the edge, polish up the inside. And I say this is so easy because it naturally will want to sit. It's very hard. If you want to, you could tip it up and round the edge, but that's not the idea. I mean, it'll just naturally want to sit between these two tram lines.
So it lends itself to the process.
Yes, that's why I came up with the idea, really, just to make it easier. And that's all it needs. And then if you want it to be really... It's a different plane coming over. If you want to be really good, you could argue you've got a slight... You could do a tiny couple of wipes the other way. So if there was a burr, you just work it back and forwards. But that's all it needs. And that should be nice and sharp now. Really, all you need to do is sharpening. It can be very quick. One other thing I'd say is that the whole idea is to keep this flat, and sometimes people will put a piece of suede around the bevel and strop with it, which does work, but particularly as you've got such a thin bevel, what will happen is the suede will compress when you apply downwards pressure around it. And you've done all this work to get it cutting flat. I mean, the last thing you do is polish it round again. So I think it's better to go directly on wood than with suede.
And I guess with suede leather, you're actually not going to physically feel it in your hands, that click when you're dead flat.
No, I mean, it will naturally want to sit flat, but because this is so thin, the bevel's only a couple of millimetres, that you'll just press in. So just the fact that you're pressing down is going to make it press in. If you had the blade which has got a big flat inside bevel, then if you press hard, it's not going to compress so much and do it. But then that's the whole point, is that this, my blade's different from most other blades out there, so it's a different sort of technique we're talking about. So that's, you know, that's how sharpening. Now at this stage of sharpening, again, ignore my technique, right hander using a left hand blade, but I should be able to do this little trick which I was used to like doing. I can cut one out and I can cut the central and I can pretty much just keep going. And say if the wood's wet, which this isn't, I can cut one so thin you can actually see the two tram lines through the blade, and that one you just about can, and you get a nice smooth finish.
Right. So I'll include some still photographs over this so you guys that are viewing it can see better, but yes. Our first one was a very toothy chip, which is pretty aggressive.
Oh, that's a horrible looking chip, isn't it? Yeah. That's a very blunt blade, admittedly, but that's the difference in sound.
The second chip looks pretty smooth, but you can see there's little teeth on there. And then the last chip he made looks very, very smooth, very sculpted wood chip. And also, it's nice to have contrasting light when you're looking at tool edges and grain, because you can see all these track lines that we're dragging through. So really, that's most important when you're trying to finish a spoon or a bowl, whatever you're carving. You know, you get this, you're almost finished, and every cut you make has lines, and then you spend ages adding more lines to your whole outside surface, especially with something like a cup. Every one of these has lines, and then when we flip it over to the polish stage, you can actually see a shine, and if you feel it with your thumb, it's very smooth. So
great. Yeah, well, yes, I think that's it, really. Well, I'd like to thank everybody who's supported my work. I've had so many questions about sharpening these tools that it seems sensible to do a video. Hopefully it's been helpful, and we should be doing some more. Okay, thank you. It's starting
again. Yes. Oh, yeah, it's a blooper reel at the end.
Oh, I'm getting there. Yeah, my hearing's going to be difficult.
It's okay if we need to do 80, I know how it is.
Yes. I'm just trying to say yes.
Yes, yeah. Okay. I've got to talk to Cap for that. No, I can't ignore it.
Might as well.
I can't ignore it. Yes, that's a good one.
So, yeah, it's going, is it?
Yeah, it's probably.
Yeah.
Yes.
Anyway, so first, I can't remember what I said next. Yes.
Can't do it.
So they're actually brilliant doing a knife, which has got the face standards.
Good catch, man.
Oh, well, I do.
After all that, I still get
blade would be just as sharp, so I'll start again. Yeah. Just in case that joke's a bit too cheesy. Yeah, so that I'd sell a blade, and people can come back a year later at the same show, show me what they've same show. Yes.
Yeah, we could also go over that again now that I'm thinking more on the post shoot.
So we can cut back. I'm going to be teaching cooks and farming workshop. So workshop.
I mean, if you want to give one more go. It's getting better.
It's always getting better. Yes, I want more go. Well, at least I've got, he's teaching cooks and gardening at my workshop rather than cooks and gardening workshop at my workshop.
Yeah.
So that was a little bit.
Is it easier if I stand here and it's if you're talking to me, or is it better if I
stand? No.
It was going so well. It was looking good, wasn't it? I thought, I can't use workshop again. I just get to have cooks
of course, yeah. Workshop, class.
That's awesome. see why it's so full. Yeah.
What's that? Sorry, I can hear.
Oh.
Cool.
Yes, so I just did lots of takes. That's the only way.
Yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, it's not a problem.
Yes. So would it just start with, I'll just stand here because otherwise I have to walk out. And just
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yes, yeah.
Just start there, and I'm rolling whenever, so there's no pressure.
All right, yes. I'll just start talking because otherwise it will just. Okay, well, so. Yeah. And off we go. Yeah, it'll be dark, it'll be pitch black.